and you know, get ready to accept that the peace dividend is finished. It's over. Which to me means that the measures of the instruments of conflict resolution that we developed internally now have to be matched with instruments of conflict resolution ignoring Europe. We can't impose Europe's soft power on the rest of the world. It doesn't work. We're not ready for that. I say things like that. It doesn't make me very popular. But that's okay.
One, two, three. Okay. Please.
Well, thank you very much for this.
Four.
Yeah. Talking about
you are next.
The post the political and the economy transformation or transition of post-communist states in Eastern and Central Europe and the current economic and social inequality in Europe. Can we discuss this within the perspective of Immanuel Wallenstein's core theory, where Europe has been divided between the core and the periphery, where these different Eastern Central European countries are much more dependent on the Western core, and this has somehow created a very weak economy in these countries of the Eastern, former communist countries in the Eastern and Central.
Entirely agree. These are dependent economies, not completely, but the freedom of action, the freedom of agency is pretty limited. I did mention Wallerstein before. I accept the centre-periphery model. It is more complex than that. But the difficulty that I see, which I'm not sure is so salient in his thinking, is the disparities of power. There's simply more economic power, also political power and cultural power in the larger states, simply because they're larger and they're capable of generating condensing much more power. Now think of the cultural power of the United States from the Hollywood Dream Factory on, the attractiveness of this to all sorts of places in the world. It's very rare, shall we say, for a Hungarian film to make it big. It happens once in a blue moon, and then it's a 3-day wonder, and then they think, oh, aren't we wonderful? But actually, that's not the reality. So how do you get out of this? Well, actually, we can never get out of this. I think that's a structural problem. Small states are confronted with a structural problem which they cannot do anything with. Unless the larger states, the larger powers, whether it's economic or political or anything else, are prepared to apply self-limitation. And they're not. The economic dimension, they're not prepared to do that at all. Politically, democracy to some degree makes you do this. Having said this, and this is the point I think at which I say some nasty things about the United States, there was this trial back in November, This is the person who incited rioters at Reske on the Hungarian-Serbian border. He was given a 10-year sentence. You can argue about this. What the United States then does is to send a note to the Hungarian government saying the government, with the help of civil society, must now take action to revise this. The government intervene in the judicial process? What nonsense is this? What kind of democracy is it? And anyway, who gives the United States the right to say to a fellow NATO member, you must now do this, etc., etc.? It was really very, very far-reaching demarche, which was rejected in no uncertain terms by the Hungarian government. And this is, by the way, coming at the end of years and years of pressure from the United States. And I've had discussions in Washington, State Department people, and they're absolutely convinced that what we have in Hungary is a semi-fascist, autocratic, authoritarian system, and this would be not last summer, the summer before when I was in Washington, I was talking to this woman who was, I think, a press advisor to Victoria Nuland, and she said to me, we're really, really very worried about Hungarian media. And I said, oh, are you really? Have you read it? I don't read Hungarian. It's there in English, you know. Silence. In other words, prejudice, the pre-digested information which they never bothered to check. Now, can you really base foreign policy on that? Well, if you're a large power, you can allow yourself these different luxuries. So, I think in answer to your question is that some of this is structural and very difficult to change. On the other hand, that, you know, have, for example, Switzerland, which had been a small state, population of 5 million, half the population of Hungary, which does generate very, very high tech output, very high level of wealth, and so on and so forth. So we have to think about the parallels if we want for this part of the world. And then our human capital is of a kind which doesn't actually help us too much.
More and more questions. Sorry.
So I'm wondering, what will be Hungary's integration into European Union after 2020? Because as I remember, in after 2020, Hungary will not have funds from European Union, if I'm not mistaken.
Will there be any
changes?
I think you may be mistaken.
I'm wrong?
You may be. We don't know, because the next financial perspective nowhere near ready to be worked out. What is quite certain, I think, insofar as you can predict the future ever, is that we're going to get the amount of money we're getting now.
Mm-hmm.
But the chances are we'll still be in receipt of some structural and cohesion funds, not to this level of generosity. And then the whole thing is complicated by the, well, I haven't used this word yet, Brexit.
Yeah.
One net contributor leaving the European Union, etc., etc., the budget shrink even further, and so on. So I don't know the answer, but in answer to your broader question is Hungary is not in the European Union only for economic reasons. I'm resistant to economic explanations without other factors.
Mm-hmm.
I think this is a Marxist legacy. It's also a liberal legacy that people are, you know, rationality is only economic rationality. No, it's not. There are all sorts of other rationalities operating. And I think that I simply cannot see the advantage of Hungary leaving the European Union after 2020 or 2021. Economic grounds. I think that being part of a network, being part of a security system, being part of a regulatory system. Can you imagine the Romanians poisoning the Tisza again?
So it was the Australians in Romania who poisoned the Tisza, not Romanians.
I think they were Canadians. But Canadians, of course, never do anything nasty like that, but it was still, I suspect, shall we say, the quality of the work done by the Romanian workmen on the tanks that held the cyanide. Honestly, this is the Romanian state, so I don't think you can excuse them.
Let's have other people, to give them a chance. Yeah, Jaroslav and Jusak, please.
Regarding your notion that each institution tends to increase its power, I'd like to ask as a practitioner, is European Parliament going to follow this pattern? Not why.
Well, this is what the European Union has been doing since the outset. All the time, the bits of paper on which the texts, and they interpret the texts in ways to ensure that they announce their power. One of the reports that I talked about, the Rock Press, the report is precisely about this. How does the European Union enlarge its powers within the terms of the treaty? It can't go beyond the treaty. And there will always be ambiguity, there will always be grey areas. Well, if necessary, they can decide to have Luxembourg Court. In which areas? Very hard to say, because I think it depends on where the issues come up. The Parliament will say, we don't want to do it like that, we want to do it like that. But let me give you one example, where there's more influence than power. When the Juncker Commission took over, it changed the structure of the Commission to create clusters. The word cluster was used at the time, it isn't anymore. In other words, portfolios which are sort of broadly related. That idea comes from a report done by Jürgen Pan. Was it 20 years, I think it was? I think it was the European Parliament, you know, with pushing the Commission in what it regarded as a more efficient way of operating. I'm not sure that it worked, but that's something else again. I'm sure there are other examples. I mean, there's, you know, the failure that I mentioned in my own experience with the European Citizens Initiative. Maybe it's not a final failure. Maybe we will be able to get the Commission to change its position on that. But in all sorts of areas which I don't see, for example, environmental protection, fighting against organized crime, and so on, though I'm sure you're involved in doing it, pushes its power as far as it can. So yes, I think is the answer to your question.
Yes, please.
Yes. So could you please share your own opinion about the importance of the EU for the UK and the importance of the UK for the EU? Just your own opinion.
So the Brexit question.
Yeah. As a member of the parliament, it's very, as in that you have on your special ideas, special opinion. This is what's interesting for me.
Well, it's my view you want, you have to understand that I'm still a British citizen, as well as I'm here as a citizen, and I'm still a British taxpayer. Because I get certain sums of money from
you. You remain in the EU, for sure.
I'm a committed remainer, which is not going to happen. I did think after the vote, maybe it won't happen. But by now, I'm absolutely persuaded that it will happen. Mm-hmm. And what kind of Brexit are we going to have? And I think, actually, I'm increasingly pessimistic. Let me tell you one thing. Just before Christmas, I was invited to London, I think it's a group called the Friends of Europe or something like that. Gave me a very nice dinner and expected me to sing for my supper. And so I talked to them about how Parliament sees it, what Central Europe wants, and so on. And then the discussion went in the direction of, well, what kind of Brexit will happen? And they're all very knowledgeable, senior members of the establishment, very pessimistic. And then there were the ultra-pessimists. In other words, the pessimists say that it will be a very hard divorce. And the ultra-pessimists say there will be no divorce at all, there will be a crash. Now, what I read and what I understand and what I hear from senior or less senior people is that the EU's perspective, you know that the negotiations are effectively headed by Michel Barnier. He did come and talk off the record. And what he said was that it's vital that the EU27 maintain its unity. No negotiations before Article 50 is triggered. And perhaps even more important, he sees the course of events as three different stages. The first stage is negotiating the exit, which also includes the problem of maybe 3 million EU citizens in Britain, and well over a million British citizens in the EU. What happens to them? I don't know. Nobody knows. There's a further problem that you may know in the United Kingdom, you don't know identity cards. And the British doesn't know where these people are. It's difficult to deport them, difficult to round them up and say, back you go home. What happens? Well, presumably, if at some point somebody stayed there illegally, then they can be deported. But that doesn't actually address the problem. What happens to the British pensioners in Spain and France? Do they get the kind of hospital health treatment which the Spanish and French states are provided? The French health system is excellent, by the way, better than the British. It's worth going to France if you're ill. And it really is superb allocation to use it once or twice. Berlin is also very good. So stage one is the divorce, and then the other side of this is the EU's position is that Britain still owes the European Union money. Its existing commitments, maybe 60 billion, the British press is climbing the walls. Says, no, 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 this isn't tolerable. The exit thing, we can't possibly pay this. That puts pressure on the government. So this will have to be negotiated very delicately. The second stage is the transitional agreement after the, whatever it is, recently earlier, March 2019, before we get into a free trade area. The outcome will probably be, at best, a Canadian-style free trade area. And then there are all sorts of extremely complicated issues to be negotiated. What happens, for example, with chemicals? Now, one of my early experiences in Parliament was voting the Chemicals Directive. It took 3 hours. Very long, very complicated. I had no idea what I was voting. Well, my colleagues in Parliament, that's the way we do things. It's a very complex regulatory system. Will Britain simply shadow the European system? Because if it doesn't, it won't be able to sell a large number of goods in the European Union. What happens to the supply chain? British motor cars are partly made with EU27 materials. I think some of the rivets are made not too far from here, in Bosch County, etc. What happens? The answer is we don't know. Or some of the argument that you say is about the tariff barriers. I actually take the view that it's the non-tariff barriers that are more important, the quality control, for example. Or will there be a single skies agreement? What happens to Ryanair? Interesting. I don't know the answer. Nobody knows. And, you know, when the Brexiteers said, we will be free, we will set up a Singapore-style Britain. I don't think these things ever occurred to us. And that, one of the things which has emerged in this last 8 months is the level of ignorance, very high levels of the British government, about the European Union. They've been a member since 1973. They had no idea what that membership actually was. The technical people knew a small slice of it. So, from the British side, I think they want these three steps to go in parallel. I think it's not going to happen. At least the European Union will do everything it can. I know that British ministers are quietly wandering around from one EU member state to the other, saying, look, perhaps we do a little private deal on the side. Brussels is saying to them, don't you dare. The more they do this, the more difficult it becomes for the EU to strike a decent deal. Because if they get the sense that Britain has been devious, and already there's a lot of impatience with Britain, even before Brexit, the general sense is that the European Union became much more directed by London, the city, free market liberalism than actually anybody else wanted. And concession after concession was made, and then damn it, the people vote to leave. So the sense that we should be nice to Britain, I think, is weak. It's not completely gone, but it's weak. So I think probably, well, let's assume that Article 50 is triggered soon, within the next month, or a little more. And then all sorts of things happen. I mean, there will be about 2 months during which the details are chewed over and digested, and the negotiations begin after the German elections. Don't expect anything to happen before that. We've got about a year in which to find the agreement for the exit. Then UK Parliament has to say yes, the European Parliament has to say yes, and if the terms are too favourable, then the European Parliament will say no, and crash. So, exciting times ahead.
Except one last question, and then a short question, a short answer, please.
Just a quick question. Is European Parliament entitled to exert pressure on member states where human rights violations? To make sure that the leaders of these countries are held responsible.
When you say exert pressure, political pressure, yes, legal pressure, basically no. The pressure is that they pass reports saying what's happening, or pass a resolution that this is terrible, must stop this. that's bound to, about to happen on Poland, and indeed the Civil Liberties Committee is holding a hearing on Hungary on Monday. If you're interested, you'll be able to watch it on webstream. So are they entitled? Probably yes. Is it helpful? Probably no. It just gets people's backs up. What I can tell you is this, there's regular meetings several times a year between the national parliamentarians and European Parliament. These are not very happy meetings. There's a certain amount of stress, tension, friction between the national parliaments and the European